This feels so primed for enterprise adoption, Brad. When I think of writing, when I think of coding, what is the opportunity there?
Yeah, well, good morning. Thanks for having me. GPT-5 is a significant step forward in a few different domains. So you mentioned coding, you mentioned writing, in health for consumers and medical professionals. And we think that opportunity unlocks an amazing set of things in the enterprise that now become possible. It's a much more reliable model, so it's better at things like calling tools. It's better at things like structured thinking and reasoning, problem solving. And what we see in the enterprise is when you make these core capabilities better, the number of use cases enterprises can adopt these models for increases. And so coding being significant, it really is the language of computers, and that was a significant area of demand for us when we were talking to customers about what they wanted in this model.
I mean, PhD level is what many are calling it, well, what Sam is calling it, and I'm sure yourself. What's interesting is when you've got 700 million weekly users of ChatGPT, how much is that a funnel, a read across into enterprise? How much do you get the inbound? Because ultimately, the people in the workforce are already using it.
Well, really early on when we launched ChatGPT, what we found is, I think, you know, a mere number of months after we launched it, I think something like 92% of the Fortune 500 were actively using ChatGPT, or people at 92% of the Fortune 500 were actively using it. And so it was very obvious for us we needed to go build a work product, because I think ChatGPT as a product is as useful in an enterprise environment, in a work environment, as it is in your personal life. It's an amazing companion if you do anything from marketing to software engineering to data analysis and research. And I think there was a lot of organic adoption when people discovered the tool, realizing that it could make people much better at their jobs and able to do more. And so we really leaned in with that, and we're trying to build the best product we can.
It's like one-tenth of the planet using ChatGPT, Brad, but I'm interested in some analysis that Menlo Ventures has done. They've analyzed the LLM market, particularly in the enterprise space, and they've just tried to push back, saying, look, you lost market share. OpenAI went from 50% in the enterprise market share down to 25%, and funnily enough, the company that they back, which is Anthropic, took the lead. What do you say to those sorts of statistics? Is it something you're seeing within your own numbers?
It's hard to measure these things. You can find measurements that say the opposite. But what we really focus on is value for customers. Like, we've got to deliver the absolute best models and then the absolute best products for developers, for startups, for enterprises, large and small. And that's been our focus. I think, you know, our API is a good example of where we've really invested lately. We've got over 4 million developers now actively using the API every day to build new products. We support thousands and thousands of startups that are building with us, that we work deeply with on trying to improve our product so that they can ultimately build a better product. And in the enterprise, I think, you know, the demand that we see there is really unabated. We grew ChatGPT enterprise seats from 3 million seats to 5 million seats in a matter of 2 months. And so that growth is accelerating, and we're just starting to scratch the surface, I think, on the impact that we can have both for developers and for enterprises. So we see it as a long game, and you know, we're here to just do our best for customers.
For that, boy, do you need infrastructure. Tell us a little bit about the costs of training this model and how you're looking to expand with Stargate, the project we've just been talking about, how SoftBank's been teaming up with Foxconn, for example, to take over an Ohio EV plant. How is that continuing to meet your demands, or not meet them, as the case may be?
Well, we've seen demand for AI increase at just a torrid pace. Obviously, at the root of that is getting right the infrastructure equation, and we think ultimately that's going to be a critical input to the U.S. And its allies being competitive in this area. And so Stargate for us was a $500 billion project to invest here in the United States to build AI infrastructure for OpenAI and ultimately for the country. We're working with a lot of great partners on that project and hope to bring in more. And I think, you know, that's just the beginning. We're going to continue to invest aggressively. We've always found ourselves somewhat on the wrong side of the demand curve for AI, despite the investment, the significant investment to date. And so for as long as we see demand, we're going to continue to invest aggressively. AI is interesting in that the more you invest and the more you make it available, the more you make it, cost approachable for enterprises and for consumers, the more people want to use it.
Yeah.
So it's an amazing trend, and we'll continue to invest behind it.
We're speaking with Brad Lightcap of OpenAI, the COO, for our radio and TV audiences. Brad, How has the rollout ultimately been, do you think? Because so many people wanted to use the app that maybe we hit limits quicker than some anticipated.
Well, we're trying our best to keep up with demand, serving infrastructure at scale at 700 million users, and then millions of developers and many, many billions of tokens per minute that we process is not for the faint of heart. Thankfully, I don't have to do that part of it, but we're doing our best to make sure the rollout is successful, and we're hoping that by the end of the week here, everyone gets access.
Your job description is more about building the enterprise relationships, the partnerships. I also think about the partnership you have with Microsoft, and Satya Nadella is out there really talking about integrating already and how excited he was for the product. But there's a tension in the relationship there. I'm interested in what you think the progress being made. Sam Altman was on networks talking about progress being made with the relationship going forward with Microsoft. Can you give us a timeline about when you think a deal will be done and the future of how they interact with your product and more broadly how much ownership they continue to have in the business as a for-profit one?
Yeah, well, we feel really positive about the relationship with Microsoft, and they've been a great partner throughout the history of OpenAI. They've, you know, been with us from the beginning, really, since before ChatGPT. Obviously, have been a huge infrastructure partner for us with Azure, and so we expect that to continue. We see no future that of OpenAI that doesn't include Microsoft in a significant way. We've got to work on what that future looks like together. We're in that process with them right now. We feel very good about it, but we think also ultimately the world is really big. And the demand for these systems and these models in the enterprise and in consumer is significant. And so they represent not only an infrastructure partner for us, but a great partner to be able to help distribute and bring the benefits of the technology to the world, given the size of their footprint. So, you know, more to work through there, but we feel good about it. And like I said, I think, you know, when we're standing at the finish line of all this, they'll be there with us.
Meanwhile, Mustafa Suleiman over at Microsoft is busy in the tussle for talent. So too are plenty of other rivals that we understand. Mark Zuckerberg busy. And what's interesting is, well, you as one of those long tenured employees and staff over at OpenAI remain committed because of innovations such as this. But what about the liquidity that we're talking about bringing to some of your, well, people that you work alongside? How is that going? We understand there might be even a $500 billion valuation involved in what is a secondary sale of your shares to the likes of Thrive Capital.
Yeah, well, nothing there to share here, but we continue to see very healthy demand for on the investor side for wanting to be, I think, part of the OpenAI journey and mission, and we're very grateful for that. And on the talent side, look, I think, you know, OpenAI was founded as a nonprofit. It was founded as a mission-driven company to be able to build, general intelligence that's beneficial for all of humanity. And we haven't strayed from that mission. I think ultimately that's what attracts talent, is people want to work for a project that's bigger than themselves and something that's going to be impactful for us and for humanity and our species. And so I think that's the thing that ultimately attracts people to where they work. Obviously, like, it's a competitive market and we continue to compete. But at the end of the day, when we ask people what it is that keeps them at OpenAI, it's the mission.
The mission. At the moment, you've got something that's generally intelligent, but it's not artificial general intelligence, Brad. When do you get there, briefly?
You know, I've sworn off making predictions in AI. It's too hard. The curves are too steep. But I think, you know, we feel really good about the rate of progress. GPT-5 is a great representation of how we start to make progress on little things. Things like, for example, being able to have the model dynamically reason and decide how much it wants to think about the problem that you ask it to solve. That's something that we do natively as humans that previously our models couldn't do. So it's these little steps forward that we think accumulate and ultimately get us to something that will be truly remarkable.